very much for your attendance this morning. Councillor, we have an apology from Councillor Chair, Councillor Chair. So, as Vice Chair, I'll take over this meeting today. I apologise first off because I've got a chest infection, so if we keep up and die, just carry on about it. We move to any other apologies.
I've received apologies from Councillor Sullivan, Councillor Bond, Councillor Cashman, Councillor Dean, Councillor Lewis, Councillor Maguire. And that's it, Mr. Chair.
Have you got a replacement for the wheel councillor who's now there?
I've been notified last Friday of rural councils appointing it needs to go to the combined authority for formal approval to start voting the CA on the next meeting on the 20th of November and then she'll inform me about it.
Thank you very much. Declaration of interest, you've started to apologise.
Apologies for actions, Councillor Anderson at that time.
Declaration of interest. Forms have been circulated with the agenda. Sorry?
Are you for it?
We are for it. Okay, thank you. I have been informed that we are for it, so I am saying we are for it.
After four.
I didn't want us to just turn up and then go home. Minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree those? Is there any matters of interest?
I haven't received any, Chair.
Sorry, matters arising. No. Okay, so can we agree those? All those in favour? Thank you very much. If we can move on, just a slight flip in the agenda, if we can move to the Liverpool City Region Growth Plan, the Metro Mobile, it's going to be slightly late, so if we can do that first and then go back to the Metro Mobile's 100-day plan.
I'll be presented, Chair. With your permission, Chair, I've brought some copies of the growth strategy, which is informing the growth plan, which might be helpful to share around members, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Okay, I'll do that and then I'll take us through just a very brief presentation.
Yeah. Have you got those copies for the general public?
I can get some by the end of the meeting, Chair, if that's
fine. Thank
I've
you.
Got some detailed ones and then some summary documents.
Can you give me a hand through to you?
Hang on. That as the basis, and we conducted then a very extensive piece of consultation for predominantly with our local authority colleagues, again at leadership and senior executive level, but also with the private sector, with business leaders, with business organisations, etc. And we produced a document that you've seen circulated, a detailed version and a summary version, which sets out a kind of overriding vision for the city region, which folks felt was appropriate. And that was that we use the core strengths that we've got, and we've got many of those that are detailed in the document that we've got, and the capacity for innovation, because this is an innovative place and has been historically, to really create this globally competitive city region that plays its part as a real part of the modern powerhouse. So that was the vision that everybody collectively signed up to. The strategy was built around three pillars, around productivity, people and place, and those three things intertwine. You have to deal with each one of those if we're going to get the kind of inclusive growth and improvement in well-being of our community that we all like to see. And so on the first pillar, that's about looking at business agenda, about how do we build on our sector strengths, how do we make those things we're great at, whether that's automotive engineering, ship repair and shipbuilding, renewable energy offering. How do we make ourselves even better, attract more investments, make the conditions for growth and productivity of those businesses even better? So that's the productivity strategy. Very much looking at building on those strengths and working to grow, increase the number of businesses, increase the growth rate of businesses, the scaling of the businesses, and particularly get more businesses, female-owned businesses, because one of the long-standing challenges here has been too few female entrepreneurs in the city region, one of the lowest rates in the country. So that's, again, all part and parcel of identifying what we need to do to drive those things. The people place, and you'll be hearing from colleagues, your board members, about sort of what's going on in that people space later, and that's absolutely this fundamental need for us. So if we're going to succeed, is to nurture the talent that we've got, make sure it enables the growth of our businesses, provides the skills that those people are developing, the right skills to get employment. So make sure there's a really good compact between employers and the mechanisms of training and development and attracting talent. But then thirdly, we've got to make sure the place is right. We have to continually work on our connectivity, whether that's transport connectivity, digital connectivity, look at green infrastructure so we can be a much greener, cleaner place. So it's an attractive place for people to live and work, to visit, and to study. We want to make this one of the most attractive places in the country, if not Europe, ultimately. We can only do that by investing in our place and enhancing our quality of place. So they were the three strands of the strategy. And that was very much endorsed by a very large consensus of folks when it was pulled together and launched last year. And the kind of outcomes that it's looking to be achieved through that strategy being followed through is a significant number of jobs, obviously reducing the unemployment rate, which remains stubbornly high, an increase in population, not massively so, that's about 100k increase in population, net increase in the number of businesses, but also in the GVA, the value that's produced by those businesses, increasing their productivity. You'll see as a result of this increased housing demand, so how do we manage that? We want to also see an increase in exports. So that was all encompassed in that growth strategy that you see. We're now working on trying to take that forward to the next stage. How do we make this core live and actually turn into projects that achieve that vision, that strategy? So we've been working on the development of an action plan in consultation again with city regions, local authorities, businesses, universities, and others. And what was you originally set out to do with that was make this a prospectus, a showcase of what the city region could deliver over the next 5 years or so, to share that with partners, investors, developers, government, to get collective buy-in. Also to produce a schedule of increasingly investable opportunities, things that can be taken forward, can make a difference, to attract investment, and then ultimately to allow us to evaluate how we're doing, because the plan's only as good as your ability to evaluate the progress you're making on it. So we got, as a result to do that, we did lots of engagement, consultations, sector boards, business groups, local authorities, combined authorities. We started to collect some of the pipeline of projects, potential projects and ideas for projects. Started looking at the gaps in analysis. Did we have everything that we needed in there? And we started to produce this initial list of potential projects into three, along those three pillars of productivity, people and place. We started to look at which were absolutely ready to go, maybe already starting, present ones, what were planned, very much got a good weight of evidence behind them, but also a lot fall into this third category, which is a challenge, what were potential things that were ideas that could really be game changing and important, but needed a lot more work and potentially could need funding, co-investments, etc. So that's the next thing we've been working on. Then what came along was, you will be familiar with, is this sort of industrial strategy green paper launched by government. So we used the work on the growth strategy and the action plan to really inform the city region's input into that industrial strategy. So we were making sure that government knew absolutely what our strengths were. So if you actually look at the industrial strategy consultation, a lot of what we put already in our growth strategy aligns very well. They have 10 pillars to our 3, but effectively most of their pillars are kind of splitting out some of the ones that are in our more conjoined pillars. So we did a lot of work. We hosted Greg Clark and the Tate with business leaders and CA and local authorities, and lots of consultation events. We met with BEIS officials to look at where the opportunities for focus are. A lot of their focus on industrial strategy is really picking those areas we're great at, and particularly the sector strengths. And on the back of that, we made a detailed submission backed by the Growth Strategy and Action Plan on this green paper consultation earlier this year. And as we've continued to evolve in this, obviously with the election of a Metro Mayor for the first time, Steve Rotherham, it was important that our growth strategy supported, aligned with, informed the kind of taking forward of the sort of mayoral priorities, and that, you know, very much linked into that evolving priorities for the mayoral combined authority. So again, the work we're doing is very much to look and support that, to work with the combined authority, to support an independent economic review of the strategic approach. I've got a pretty good bill of health from Lord O'Neill that identified areas that we need to strengthen. So we're now looking at how do we strengthen the evidence base so we have a really evidence-based city region investment strategy that says what are our priorities, what are the things that are going to give us the biggest impact. So if you look through the documents of Trudy's state here, there's an awful lot in there. If we were to deliver everything in there, the city region would absolutely be booming. But we're going to have to prioritise. That's the challenge we've got with the funds that are available. We need to prioritise the use of those funds. We also need to look at range of other funds that could be available to us through government, through European sources, through commercial sources. We have to become much more effective at drawing funding in from multiple sources, because you all know, you live and breathe it in local authorities, how challenging the financial landscape is at a local level. So we've got to be much more creative, commercial and inventive. So that's what we've been doing. We're continuing to engage with partners, businesses and organisations to kind of develop the priorities and project lists. We're starting more work now on really getting to the bottom of the evidence base we've got and whether there are any gaps in that evidence base that we really need to get to the heart of this investment strategy. And all the time we're out there in our engagement with businesses, particularly in the public sector, to look at what projects could kind of fulfil the ambitions and aspirations set out in that strategy. Chair, I'll leave it there, but I'm very happy to take any questions that you all or members of the panel have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Information there. Do we have any questions for Mr. Bartlett? Tony?
Thank you. I'm sure the presentation is very informative and the information is key. I just wanted to ask a question about the same process screening. How we can help this committee and also work at the independent. This is the first time we've seen the presentation, and also the first time we've seen the booklet. There's quite a lot of it. So I just could say a proposal, and in this way, in the future, bit of a background report at the beginning, but in terms of support and then the cultural representation of the country, not just for this work, but other work as well, because there's a hell of a lot of work there. And so we can add and admit what's going on, we'd like to ask questions. So, you know, we can ask questions, we've all got the ability to do that, and I'll ask them in a minute. But also, you know, so we can be more effective. So you can be more effective, and we can be more effective in terms of our school people. So that's the proposal there, that we get some sort of background information. So we're getting this cold in some place. That's the first point. Yeah. And the second point would be, in terms of the work that's going on, brilliant. What are the performance indicators going to be in place to make sure that this big plan is actually done? So two points really. Thanks.
I'm happy to try and pick both of those up. In terms of papers that might support this and other presentations, background papers, I think it's probably for the administration side of the committee to determine what's the best way of doing that. Very happy to feed all of our information in. Very happy to, if you think it would be helpful, to make sort of copies, detailed copies available to every council member, so there's greater visibility. If it would be helpful, certainly personally, I'd be happy to address any groups of members by authority to talk through where we're at with the growth strategy, the priorities, share the document, answer questions. Delighted to do that, because this will only work if we collectively own it, if we all kind of understand it, understand where the opportunities are, and challenges, and that's absolutely, these things only get better by having constructive challenge, so we're very, very open to that, absolutely, and kind of a very consultative approach on that basis. So practical things, certainly we can sort of provide information to provide background papers and help write those, but equally, if it's helpful for myself or anyone of our team to come out and brief any member groups, committees within the authorities or cross authorities, we're delighted to do that. Is the first. The second point on key performance indicators, it's absolutely vital that we develop a really robust set of indicators, but they have to be the right ones. They have to be the things that if we measure them, we know we're getting to where we want to be. And traditionally those have been the number of people in employment, the unemployment rate, what's often called gross value added, which is the value that the economy adds here, not just imported goods, but the value that we produce to grow the economy. Those are all important, productivity of businesses. So we're actually in the process now of trying to determine what are exactly the right criteria, because we have those, and we measure them, we do measure those. We measure the number of businesses, we measure productivity by local authority area, we've got all kinds of detail. So we want to make sure we're measuring the right things for the strategy so that we're then working to improve those, and they're the things that will benefit your constituents, etc. But we also want to make sure, again, that you're comfortable that we're measuring the things that matter to you and to your residents in this, because again, we've got one economy, there needs to be one plan. The whole point of doing this was to have one growth strategy that everyone thought, yeah, I get why we're doing that, let's all work together. Because in the past there have been too many. There was 30 odd different strategies when we started this piece of work, and this draws it together. So again, very much welcome input into those things. We've got the core key performance indicators. It's getting to the next level of detail of what we measure, and by, is it by authority area, etc. What's the level of granularity that's necessary to really help inform you? Is it making a difference? Our efforts and investments in this space are making a difference in your areas, to your residents. That's what matters about this piece of work. Okay, Paul? Your vision is for average
is absolute based on the reality. As well as that, I'm a very strong believer that the people who know best what to scrutinise are the people who do not aware. So from your own perspective, what are you doing to support on, and what would you welcome your feedback as a five other investment centre?
Well, I don't know what our homework on that, obviously. Productivity issue is a massive one. It's a massive one for the UK. We've been very effective in creating jobs, and there's a very proper debate about the jobs that have been created. Are we not achieving productivity? Because the productivity of the job has come down because employers have been employing people rather than investing in productivity. If we're going to compete globally, we've got to start to switch that. We still need more jobs. There's still, you know, parts of our communities where there's far too low high levels of unemployment. We have to skill people to a level where they can get those jobs. And some of those need to be entry-level jobs, let's be candid about it. But we also need to really encourage and support businesses, particularly SMEs, because SMEs, you know, constitute 95%+ of our economy in terms of the number of businesses. We have to make it more easier and more attractive for them to invest. So the sorts of things, we're developing a number of productivity-based programs at the moment, some of the RDF funding, helping businesses adopt digitization and becoming more effective and productive through digitization. It is that breaking down of what is it that stops a business being more productive and more competitive. It's a whole range of things. But access to capital is key, encouragement of investment, innovation is absolutely vital. Digitization is going to be a way, automation can be a way. Some of the things that, so you take someone like France or Germany, the better productivity figures than ours have per worker. Interestingly, in those areas, it's easier for, let's say it's harder for employers to have much less flexible labour regulations, so, and there's much more encouragement for investments in systems and processes. I think we have to grasp that metal in this country. We have to encourage productivity much more by the generation of use of automation, the use of productivity. We have to become skilled in those areas. But we will see in some places that will have a negative impact on jobs in some businesses. But if we don't embrace that, we risk becoming less competitive, and those businesses ultimately fail because they're not competitive. So it is that those figures we've modelled through a company called Cambridge Econometrics. They've done the modelling of the things we've put in that strategy. They did that objectively. So they've worked on the basis that we can do that. In some areas, if you take our manufacturing sector, and it's led by the bigger manufacturers, we're actually more productive than anywhere else in the Northwest in this far world. So we have got some very good positives in there. We're talking to companies, and sorry, this is all out to share. We're talking to some companies like Jaguar Land Rover and others about the sort of great productivity gains they've been making in their businesses to help them cascade it down into the supply chain so that their suppliers can be more productive, because that's the way you can get it down. So that's the first half. We have to encourage an atmosphere of investment and not just employment at the lower end. Secondary, in terms of what measures do we think, I'd like to be getting to a really good granular level of a hard evidence base, so not just figures that look like things are going fine. The only way we're going to move forward is to be absolutely transparent and honest with ourselves about how we're moving forward. Now, sometimes we may be wanting to talk to a different audience than a scrutiny committee, where we should be completely transparent. You know, it's not about us trying to defend ourselves. My view is we should be completely open, and we should all know what our issues are, and we only do that by having a really robust evidence base and getting underneath the skin of it. Sometimes to an external audience, you may want to put a different nuance on that because you're trying to promote the positives about the place. But my view is we have to get absolutely under the skin on productivity. We need to do that by sector. We need to do it by geography to see if there's any geographic to by size of our business. And we're starting to collate that evidence right now. On entrepreneurship, I want to see a much more rigorous evaluation of female entrepreneurship. We're missing lots of potential female talent driving leading businesses in the city region. If we had the same number of women running businesses in the city region as we have there, our economy would be one of the best in the UK. We really have and there are all kinds of reasons for that, which we need to get under the skin of. So it's about getting the indicators up. How do we break that down? So it's not just about reporting activity, it's about getting under the skin of the things that really tell us where our economy is. And we are completely committed to that, as is the combined authority. I know from the work that we've been doing with Steve Rotherham, some of that supported by the sort of Harvard University, which is working with cities around the globe, to absolutely get under the skin of how their economies are working and what's going to drive their growth in the future. We're working with them to try and make sure we've got the evidence base. And I've got a meeting with them on Monday to get improve our data sets, how we can use their insights and help to improve our data sets. So apologies if that's a long answer, Chair, but it's a very, very good question, because the both of them cut right at the heart, absolutely cut right at the heart of what we're doing.
Yes, Laura Robertson Collins, and also from the City Council. Just to urge, and it may well be in the document or strategy somewhere, about the inclusion of digital inclusion as an area that's important for growth strategy. Obviously, the high end of digital is something we absolutely need to focus on. That's kind of, you know, really developing the high end of skills, which I think all growth strategies seem to apply, because that's quite glamorous. But obviously, if we still have 20% of our population don't have access to the internet, then that's not just a social justice issue, though it is a social justice issue, but it's a massive issue for skills. And if we don't remember that not everyone still doesn't have access to the internet when we're talking about jobs and skills growth, then it's just I'm sure you are aware of it, and it may well be in the document, and I haven't found it yet, but just that digital inclusion goes hand in hand with those other growth strategies.
Thank you. That's a really good insight. It's a challenge that cities around the UK are facing. There's been a really interesting piece of work done by O2 in St Helens. St Helens was probably one of the poorest performing in terms of digital access and inclusion. And the findings of that piece of work that they've done has made a significant increase in digital inclusion. And we're actually working with them now to look at, can they perhaps broaden some of that work out into some of those areas. But absolutely, as we move to a digital world, everything's going digital. We think we've just started on that journey. And if people don't have access, they don't know how to use it. And that's right across it. It's an income issue. Sometimes it's an age issue. It's a community. We absolutely have to grasp it. So, if it's not articulated strongly enough in there, that would be a mistake on our part, because we absolutely recognise that it's fundamental. It's a very important point.
Okay. Sorry, I can't see. Your name.
Thank you.
In that space that we're still looking at the range of interventions we need to stimulate gender and sort of people from ethnic origin, and sometimes migrants. Interestingly, if you look at the stats nationally, migrants have a much higher propensity to start businesses and can be very successful and add to economies, and sometimes that's overlooked. So we're in the middle of trying to pick all of that. What are the interventions needed around all groups, so that we have diversity has to include all of those groups. And we shouldn't just focus. Gender is obviously a huge, you know, a very current issue, and rightly so. And it is around boardroom tables as well. And it's good that that issue to recognise the positive impact that women can have around the boardroom. But we need to make sure it includes all thirds of the group. So it is certainly on our radar. We've started to work on a much broader diversity and inclusion agenda, because if we're going to be successful, we have to reach into every single part of our communities and tap into the talent and capability in those areas. It's incumbent upon us to do that. Otherwise, we're not going to realise our potential. So again, it's another good point. I will certainly make sure that that's reflected in the work that's taken forward.
Yeah. Just one question for yourself. I want to go back to Tony's point first, to say that this strategy is a fairly new strategy. Although the MEP for the city needs to be working on strategies for a number of years, this is the first time we've actually had a clearly defined strategy for the city region. So it is fairly new. It would be nice to have some historical context of how we got to where we are now. So that may work. I'd also like to see maybe an annual report on where we are, how we're doing it, and I'm going to ask the meeting of the team to get the answer to speak to our question. The second part was on the physical connectivity with regards to transport. We have free flowing transport links by the M62. We don't seem to have, or we do have now have free flowing, but with the added penalty of tolls across the Mersey Gateway and the tunnels, how is this affecting business, especially SMEs, and how is it being perceived now that the new crossing is open? How is business actually reacting to the tolling across the two links into Wales and into the M56?
Thank you, Chair. I'll answer the first question first. This point of was very happy to provide the historical context. A little bit is summed up in that piece of work, which again is a consultative piece of work that was done on the state of the city region by the universities, as an objective piece of work that took about 6 to 9 months. As you say, this strategy, single strategy, is relatively new, but like all strategies, it has to be dynamic and has to reflect that we've now got an emerging industrial strategy, and we've got to make sure that the things that we put in place reflect the opportunities that arise from that. And obviously we have a metro mayor with clear visions for where the things we should focus on around digitisation and digital inclusion around renewable energy, etc. So it has to move, a document or has to be dynamic, and this will be that. Trying to explain the work we're doing is evolving to that evolving landscape. So on the point of annual review, absolutely, we're going to produce in the early part of 2018, January time, kind of a baseline review of where we are, what progress has been made, and the intention is to make that an annual review, so we can see year by year the point that we made about picking the right key performance indicators, that we have those and we can measure and report against them very openly, transparently, how we're doing, so everybody knows how we're doing. There's no smoke and mirrors, there's no manipulation of stats to tell a story that you want to make yourself look good. This has to be, these are the performance indicators, and we report them honestly so everybody can see them. That has to be the baseline for how we move forward. You're asking me to step into interesting waters there, Chair, on the Mersey Gateway and tunnels. I'm not a politician, I'll need to be careful about my response. From a business perspective, and that's the only way I can answer this, we have not picked up a body of resistance from businesses about the issue of tolling, either on the tunnels or on the 62. So as you say, the link into Mersey Gateway, it's not been articulated through us. What we hear all of the time is businesses want certainty, they welcome investment in infrastructure, they want things to move quickly. Because if you're in an HGV or whatever, a delay of 20 minutes in a queue, 30 minutes in a queue, or the fact that you can't rely on whether you're going to get over average. So you have to allow an extra half an hour to your journey if you go to the port or that. Those uncertainties add massive costs to businesses, and most cost businesses, whilst they probably like the best of both worlds, as we all would, which is the free-flowing, brilliant infrastructure and no costs, of course we probably don't all like that. I think that businesses largely would take the latter and probably accept. They live in a world where you pay for things in that sense. They don't expect that necessarily for free, so I think that they're generally be supportive of the approach, providing the costs are equitable. Not for me to speak for residents in that space, it's a whole thing.
It was purely on the business side that I wanted to
I'm sure, Chair, there will be folks who are not happy about it, and some small businesses, the point was made earlier about small and micro businesses, some of those may find it hardest, and we need to be mindful of that. But certainly, we have not had any sort of weight of concern articulated through us, either about where the tunnels are, nor where the developments of the Gateway Bridge thing. Most people are proud to see a level of investment in infrastructure and a bridge that's an absolutely stunning piece of adding to the infrastructure. We've mainly seen it as a positive, and it's been fed back to us as seen as positive by the business community.
That's a brilliant answer. Thank you very much. Any other questions for Matt? Thank you, Matt.
Well, a pleasure. Thank you, Chair. Thank you.
We'll move on to the next item, which is the student review of the message to the public. Rob, if you would like some opportunity to say what you think.
Thanks, Chair. For members' benefit, my name is Rob Tapp. I work in the Command Authority here in the Employment Skills Team. And this is Siobhan Saunders. Siobhan runs the Employment, Learning and Skills Division on the Council and Chairs and Secretariat Apprenticeship. Last year, I've got a detailed report which sets out where we're up to and what the progress is, where we've delivered certain things, where we've delivered certain things early as well. We've just got a few slides to try and give you a flavour to dig into the detail of some of those issues as well. You may be pleased to know I'm not proposing to go through the report line by line in detail, but I just wanted to give you a flavour of what we've been able to do and some of the highlights so far. The review was undertaken by many of you last year. We heard evidence from employers, from providers, from apprentices, and from the Apprenticeship Hub as well about what some of their issues were. I think it would be fair to say that the feedback we got was that members valued the review learned a lot from it and came up with some really grounded recommendations. They were agreed in January of this year, and the Command Authority accepted those recommendations and developed a set out an action plan in December, in March of this year. In terms of other context, things that have happened since that point, it'd be fair to say that there is significant uncertainty at the moment with apprenticeships due to the large number of reforms that are being taken forward. You may be aware that large businesses now need to pay an apprenticeship levy, so any business that has a pay bill of more than £3 million a year now has to pay a levy of 0.5% of its annual pay cost. That applies to every single organisation. If you've got about 120 staff earning about £25,000 a year on average, then your organisation will have to now pay the apprenticeship levy. And that money at the moment can only be used to pay for training costs. You pay half of the apprenticeship training costs, the balance is paid by the government. What that has led to is, because there's changes in how the funding is routed through to providers, to universities and independent training providers. That's led to a reduction in starts from May of this year. And actually what we saw anecdotally was employers and providers trying to get new new starts, accelerated new starts in before that new system took place. And what you tend to see when you have changes in systems and funding is a drop off as they're introduced, and then it will stabilise over time. Nationally, we've had a fall in apprenticeship starts. The early numbers would seem to suggest that they are in steady for the city region. But we are continuing to lobby government over how the apprenticeship levy is deployed. The very well-timed Metro Mayor is in constant dialogue with government around actually how we do this, because I think there's an opportunity for us to use some of that funding, perhaps like some of those underspent better. I'm going to ask Siobhan just to give you a sense of some of the work that the Hub's undertaken, and then there'll be some further feedback in a moment.
Good morning, everybody. So rather than sort of blind with lots and lots of statistics, etc., just really to give you an overview of some of the work that the Apprenticeship Hub is involved in. We were fortunate as a combined authority to secure quite a lot of money, £875,000, to run a project from, I mean, it actually started in May this year, and it will run until the end of July next year. And associated with that are a number of strategic deliverables. So up on the screen, rather than lots and lots of statistics, are some images of some of the outreach events that the Apprenticeship Hub is involved in. And just to really give you a refresh, really, the Hub is kind of an impartial body that's acting on behalf of all of the agencies within the city region, the local authorities, colleges, providers, employees, etc., to offer advice, guidance, support, sponsorship, to drive kind of the apprenticeship agenda forward in the city region. So just a few kind of images up there, so some of the outreach events that the Hub's been involved in. Within this target, within the project, we've got to deliver nearly 600 targeted outreach meetings. Now that could be to go into a school, speak to some young people, it could be to have a one-to-one with an employer, it could be to go to a Job Centre Plus event, etc. The idea behind it is that it's just a targeted meeting where we are passing on information about the apprenticeship agenda. So there's just some of the images there. We've supported the Festival of Learning that happened in Liverpool with the trade union education. We've done a number of school events. What I've put in there is just really to date, so from May really when the project started to September, where we've had some of these meetings and the boroughs where they took place. And we're really keen to make sure that we've got
attention,
this spread.
Attention please. Attention please. We are about to commence a test of the fire alarm system. Do not take any action when you hear the alarm message.
Attention, please. Attention, please. An incident has been reported within the building. Please wait for further announcements. Attention, please. Attention, please. An incident has